Hi, welcome back to The Shtick in my living room. I'm so happy to have invited a guest that I'd never met before, but she's almost as famous as I am. Her name is Bettina Spivakovsky.
Well done.
I did it.
You did it.
That's such a tongue twister.
Well, it's easy. It's easy.
I'm going to change it to Spiva or Spiv, like most people do. They cut their name.
Yeah.
What have you done?
Well, I cut my name. Instead of Bettina, it's B.
B.
It's B.
Let it be.
Let it be, and they can say whatever it is. It's a bitch, it's beautiful, it's whatever. B is the name.
It's a beautiful name. I really like it.
Thank you.
I'm so happy to have you in my studio and to get you finally on the shtick.
Thank you.
We have been friends on Facebook for years, but I know now a lot more about you since I was introduced to you by my mate Marty Abraham, who told me that you're doing a people's choir.
Indeed I am.
That's the main reason you're in here. Indeed. But we'll get onto that later. First of all, I'd like to have a little bit of a background. Your family's from Odessa.
Yes, it
originally
is.
In the Ukraine.
Correct.
So do you have any family still there?
No, I don't have any family there. I have some family in England, and I've got some family in Westport, Connecticut.
Right.
And family here in Australia. They all came out very early on, patronised to come out and sort of start the music scene, the classical music scene here in Australia and in Melbourne. There were a lot of Spivakovskys at the conservatorium. It almost was like the conservatorium of Spivakovskys, and they were all my teachers. And I'm very grateful for that because they gave me some wonderful methods of working, living and using music in my life. And I can't be more grateful to my family.
Yeah, so your background is actually in music because your family were all musicians.
That's right.
Just about.
Well, or just about. They were all artists, musicians, some visual artists, photographers, extraordinary family, nine of them. And they were all at a certain level. They were all maestros or protégés.
Mm. Top of the tree.
Yeah, they were. Gosh, did I disappoint?
No, well, you've done very well. You've managed to have a degree in music from the conservatorium. What did you call it? What was that other word you used?
I call it the crematorium.
Crematorium. Because no, that's not fair.
It's not very fair and it's not very nice. But there were some people there that just were churning out the same sort of lectures for years in a row. Mm. And, if it could have been avoided, which I did, some of them, the lectures. I just picked up the lecture notes outside their door and made it that way through my bachelor and then did an education year, postgrad in Swinburne Film and Television, and just kept going with the arts. But it's sort of what it's done, it's led me to where I am today, which is really interesting. And I'm having the best time of my life in what I'm doing right now, actually.
Wonderful. Well, we'll take you right back to the 80s where you started in a band, in a group, in a girly group. Mm. It's probably one of the first girly groups besides the Andrews Sisters. Because there weren't that many girl groups. And there was a comedy ensemble of usually four girls.
Yes.
And it was a lot of fun.
It was. It was called the Hot Bagels, and it wasn't actually meant to exist. I was looking for management. I thought, I'd finished all of what I'd finished. I wanted to perform. I needed management. I was looking, and I went to a place called the Australian College of Entertainers. Ooh. And I saw a young woman singing there, and I thought, oh, I like that voice. I thought, her voice and my ambition, we're going to make it.
Who was
and
that?
That was Anna Fishman.
Anna Fishman, always the voice.
Always the voice.
Yes.
And I pursued Anna. I did. I kept bringing and saying, come on, let's do something together, because the person who introduced me was the principal of the school. That she knew my father, who taught at Scotch and also at the conservatorium. And she dragged me around the different classes, and I heard Anna singing. And Anna, I pursued her. I found her number. I said, give me a number. Next thing you know, can my sister come too? And that was Lena.
Yep.
And the next thing you know, Lena, I said, yes, of course, because I thought, but Lena was more of an actress at the time, not so much a singer.
Correct.
So then it was a matter of, well, what do we do now? And so I thought, well, we'll change it to a comedy act. And so then we needed a pianist, somebody to accompany, because it had to have music in
it. You're a pianist yourself, but you were standing up. You weren't sitting down.
I was in the front line, yeah.
You were
yeah.
in the middle.
Yeah, so that's why we started looking for pianists, and then there were a variety of men that came to audition, and then Nahama Patkin came.
Nahama?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
She was involved. I didn't know that.
She was wonderful, but she was also very, very classical trained, and and the flexibility sometimes, it's there, but not what we needed. And then came Irene or Tommy Kalinske.
Tommy Kalinske.
And in between that was Henry Diner, who's actually accompanying me in the choir right now. He's my accompanist, right. Which is wonderful.
Wonderful.
And so he didn't get the gig then, but he got the gig now.
Wonderful. Years later.
Yeah, so.
And then after that, who was playing on the piano?
Piano was Annabelle Taylor or Annabelle Kapek or Chapek.
Kapek.
There's so many different ways of pronouncing.
Mm.
And in between, Helena Wagen. So there was a number of different piano players that came in, but the most
famous people you had on was Libby Gore.
Libby Gore took my position in the choir and where I was singing and what I was doing. But before that was Rachel Berger.
Rachel
was doing.
Only hello, Rachel, in Tasmania.
A couple of years, or not even a couple, of weeks. I think she got a little bit mishiga when things started getting hot in a dressing room. You know, you get four Jewish hot women together, and the temperature goes up.
If you can't handle the heat, get out of the kitchen.
Get out of the kitchen. So she got out pretty quickly.
Fantastic.
And then came Libby.
So that's a fantastic background you had, which makes you very funny, because I love your sense of humour.
Yes, comes from a lot of pain.
Well, that was from the audition, and not the interview that you did on Good Afternoon Australia, when you were talking about Jewish suffering, you know, where the humour comes from.
Yes.
It's from first you do the suffering and then you do the humour.
Yes, indeed.
It's true.
Yeah. It's true, it's the foibles of mankind are there.
Mm. Mm. And then you went into Upfront Events, which is something that really took a lot of your time for 35 years. Mm. So you were a source of talent, and that's what Upfront was, really, for corporate gigs and
it was.
All of that.
So yes, the gigs that I couldn't do anymore, I was double booking. I was then booking artists into gigs that I couldn't do.
Yep.
And then somebody said, look, you're forming an agency, why don't you just take some commission, or why don't you just
make a living already.
And I thought, oh, wow. And I remember the first moment I got $25, I thought, oh, I've just made $25. And I've made it from sitting on the phone and saying, this is the time in which they arrive in this, and typing out. I had to learn typing.
Mm-hmm.
I could play piano, so that wasn't too difficult, but it was an interesting journey, and that was how the agency started. Word of mouth, and it kept going, and did some of the largest top corporate sort of events around Australia and some offshore, yeah.
Wonderful. We're going out now, and we'll be back with you to talk about what we really had you on the show for. And so we'll be back with Bettina after the break.